Right now on Colorado Point of View, a sprint to the finish for the 2022 legislative session.
I move the House adjourn sunny day. Yeah.
Republicans try to run out the clock on dozens of bills as Democrats try to keep their biggest promise to you.
We're reducing fees and costs to save people money.
We're committed to saving Coloradans money and reducing costs.
Trying to reduce costs and save people money.
So, will the laws passed this session actually save you money? Lawmakers from both sides of the aisle join me with their Colorado point of view. And embattled Mesa County Clerk Tina Peters, now barred from overseeing her own county's election. Our political panel on how this affects the race for Secretary of State. That and more right here, right now on Colorado Point of View. A very good morning to you. I'm Matt Morrow, and this is Colorado Point of View. The state capitol, quiet right now after a few marathon sessions and late nights as this year's legislative session finally came to a close this week. Democrats began the session with the theme of this, saving you money. Republicans were on board with the idea, but not necessarily on how to agree with Democrats to make that happen. It was more apparent than ever in the final days of the session. Take a look.
Let's read this at length. I make move. Motion that we read at length.
That's a proper motion. The bill will be read at length.
House Republicans using tactics just like that to filibuster for some 18 hours on Monday. Then early Tuesday morning, they put an end to that, and bills started moving quickly, including many that Democrats felt fit their goal of saving you some cash. One bill that'll do that, in the short term at least, is a delay of new gas and vehicle fees or taxes, whatever you want to call them, that was set to go into effect in July of this year. Remember, Democrats and a few Republicans passed it and praised it last year, with the governor famously saying it's time to, quote, fix the damn roads. Now they're calling it a win to delay the price hike until April of 2023. Meanwhile, most Republicans want the bill scrapped entirely. But that's not all. In the final days of the session, lawmakers also passed a $700 million property tax cut that'll last for the next 2 years. These cuts will go to people who own both homes and businesses. And lest we forget, lawmakers passed a bill that put even more money in your pocket, money that was really yours to begin with in the form of income tax refunds. In fact, they grew this week. Governor Jared Polis now says the Tabor refund checks that'll come earlier than usual will now be at least $500 for single filers and $1,000 for joint filers. Check your mailbox in late August for that cash. And speaking of the governor, here's what he's saying about this year's session.
I think when it came down to it, rather than 50 ways to save you money, there are hundreds and hundreds of ways to save people money, including $500 to save people money with the tax rebate checks. And of course, with a property tax cut, that's an average of about $275 for every homeowner.
And right now, we are getting bipartisan and bicameral to break down the last 5 months into about 5 minutes here. Joining me now, Democratic State Senator Chris Hansen, who helped craft that property tax cut I just mentioned, and Republican Representative Colin Larson. Gentlemen, thank you so much for being here. I appreciate it very much. Bottom line, at the end of the day, we know money, inflation, gas prices, you name it, top of mind for most people in Colorado today. Did Democrats, which control pretty much all of state government right now, the House, the Senate, and the governor's office, did they do enough to make that happen?
Well, Matt, I appreciate that question because we stayed focused on that during the entire session. And you saw the governor highlight some of those points this morning, the property tax, which I was heavily involved with, the Tabor refund checks that are going to come back a year early are now $1,000 per couple. The property tax is going to deliver several hundred dollars of relief to every homeowner in the state, as well as relief for commercial businesses. So I think we've really delivered on that promise.
Okay. Representative Larson, your thoughts on that?
Yeah, and thanks for having me, Matt. So, you know, I think that the general theme of this session was it's a bait and switch. You know, the property tax cuts were nice, except for the fact that Coloradans are still facing roughly $2 billion, even with the $700 million, which I think is more $500 million. We can get into that later. They're still facing a $2 billion increase in property taxes over the next 2 years, according to most projections, based on this new assessment rate. You're also seeing, you know, it's nice that I guess people will get their Tabor refund checks in September when their ballots arrive instead of next April when they would typically. But again, that's not really getting people money they wouldn't have already gotten. My head is still spinning a little bit to see Democrats do a 180 on celebrating Tabor. I'm glad that they're finally on board, and welcome to the party. But I would say that it's kind of a lot of smoke and mirrors and, frankly, not a lot of substance.
At the end of the day, though, does this put more money in people's pockets? And is it at least something, say, that's better than nothing?
You know, on the property tax, yes. I mean, $500 million is a lot of money. Absolutely. And that's why I ended up supporting the bill at the end of the day. But we got to keep in mind the context here, that there were other proposals moving forward that I was heavily involved with, other people were involved with, that would have delivered more substantial breaks and property tax increases. And again, the context that's lost is that people were facing a $2.7 billion tax increase this year. I think everyone that owns a residential property, commercial property, got an eye-popping assessment probably in January of this year. That's not even the worst of it. If we don't do anything in 2024, those numbers are going to be even worse. So I think this is the context we need to keep when we're thinking about whether or not we got a property tax cut. We need to remember we're still seeing a massive increase. It's just slightly less than it would have been otherwise.
Now, you talk about kind of property taxes, just the cost of living here in general. A new report out just the other day said that the average housing price in Colorado now hitting $600,000. It's some $685,000 here in the metro area, more in Denver. Senator Hansen, do Republicans and Representative Larson have a point when they say, why not try to make some of these tax cuts permanent, especially when it comes to property taxes, to try to keep more people in their homes and to make it more affordable to live here?
Yeah, I think what Representative Larson was totally leaving out is how does he want to fund the services that we all count on? Because the property tax proposal he got behind would have taken tens of billions of dollars out of our school system. That seems like a terrible solution, even in this moment where we're underfunding the schools. So I think what you saw the Democrats lead on was dialing it into the right level. We're trying to respond to the moment. Obviously, we've got high inflation, rising costs. Let's deliver immediate tax relief, but to do it in a way that doesn't impinge on our schools, teacher pay, being able to make sure we have a reliability of our retirement system, like PARA, right? All these important things that the people of Colorado rely on, they need funding. And so we delivered relief, but did it in a responsible way, not trying to put a formula into the Constitution, which we know doesn't work. We tried it with Gallagher, and it was a disaster.
Okay. Is this going to be the same topic, a same theme next year? This whole idea of giving people money back, trying to put more money in their pockets?
I think absolutely. I mean, we're in a situation where the economy is very strong right now, but we've got some headwinds like inflation and cost of living that you mentioned. And so I think you really saw us trying to carefully do the math, get out the spreadsheets. How can we respond in a careful way, again, without defunding the schools? And so you see us strike that balance, and I think that's responsible by the legislature.
All right. One thing that you wish, Representative Larson, that you think the Republicans would have been able to push through?
Well, in all honesty, at this point, I think it would have more been holding things back. We saw a collective bargaining at the local level, which is going to cost tens of millions of dollars for services that people are already getting. We saw some really irresponsible legislation, this so-called producer responsibility bill that's going to, frankly, heap fuel on the fire of inflation, pass costs on to people in a totally irresponsible way. And frankly, we saw some changes to the building code that's going to make housing more expensive. You know, it's kind of one of these things. The majority has been pursuing these goals relentlessly for the last 4 years. I think they're realizing in an election year that people are actually feeling the pain here, trying to at least temporarily delay it. I hope I'm wrong, but in 2023, we're going to see those gas fees kick back in. We're going to see people not getting their tax refunds that year because they were prepaid. So I think we're going to see a lot of pain in 2023 after people have cast their ballots. You know, and I just think that we owe the people a little bit longer term vision on that and not play politics.
So. Okay. Of course, we'll see what happens next year. Meanwhile, of course, one of, if not the most high-profile bills of the session, the controversial Fentanyl Accountability and Prevention Act. With less than 2 hours left in the session, lawmakers passed it, but not without some drama. That bill now makes it a felony to possess 1 gram or more of the deadly drug. 1 gram. Many Democrats in the House wanted the words knowingly possess in the bill. They wanted those in there. But the Senate stripped that out, and after hours of negotiations on the final day, that word knowingly was left out. Senator Hansen, you are on the final conference committee for this bill. Are you satisfied with it? Do you think it's going to do enough to stop the fentanyl epidemic and save lives here in Colorado?
Yeah, Matt, I think we took a huge step forward with this bill, and I appreciate you mentioning that debate that went on between the two chambers. And I think the Senate strengthened the bill. And then, as you said, late yesterday, we got to a final compromise on how to handle that piece of the bill. And I think we've put the tools that are needed into the hands of law enforcement and into the DAs, the prosecutors. I talked a lot with DAs all around the state as we were working on that bill, and I think we got to a great place last night that's going to protect public safety.
Representative Larson, you voted against this. What would you have liked to see in it? What would you want to see different with it for your vote?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And, you know, I will agree with Senator Hansen to a limited degree here. I do think that the Senate version was far better, and I was in preference of seeing us adhere to that position. This gets a little semantic, but frankly, it came down to the ability to effectively disrupt the fentanyl supply chain. And frankly, the language the Senate had, removing that knowingly possess, would have given law enforcement the tools to take these dealers and disrupt the supply chain, maybe really make a difference. Unfortunately, the compromised version of the bill, the bill that passed the House, and we've heard from law enforcement already last night, we're seeing stories this morning, it simply does not give them the tools to effectively disrupt supply chain. There's also provisions in there that allow dealers who have dealt a drug, killed somebody, to get out on probation. There's some really lacking parts in law enforcement that I think you need to take a holistic view. When you're trying to deal with this very complicated crisis, you can't just focus on harm reduction and drug treatment. That's an important part, but we need the effective law enforcement tools, and those just weren't there in that final bill.
There's been some criticism of the bill by folks who are very progressive who say this is going to put a typical drug user in jail and criminalize them. Do either of you believe that that's going to happen, that if you're a one-time drug user, or your first offense where you're caught, rather, that you're going to end up in jail and the jail and the prisons are going to get overcrowded because of this?
I don't think that's going to be the case at all. I think with the final product that I think was significantly improved by the Senate, we had some, I think, bad amendments that went on in the House. We made corrections, and that's one of the great things about a bicameral process. But no, I don't think that's going to be a danger. And if you look closely at the vote count in both chambers, who didn't vote for it? It was the far right and the far left. So that probably tells you we got it about right. And I think that's exactly what we did, and it's going to significantly improve public safety.
Yeah. Well, I would disagree with the characterization. Actually, the far right did vote for it. I do agree with the underlying point. I don't think that ultimately this is going to end up with putting low-level drug users. I think everyone in the law enforcement community understands that that was kind of a failed policy that we've had. There's an amount of prosecutorial discretion. I don't know any DA who thinks that it's a wise use of public resources to put low-level drug users in the county jail. They're much better off going into treatment. And I think this bill absolutely allows discretion for that. And I think the stronger version of the bill would have allowed that as well.
Let's hope it saved lives at the end of the day. Representative Colin Larson, Senator Chris Hansen, thank you both for being here. It's been a long session. I appreciate your time very much.
Thank you.
Many people had a lot to gain during this year's legislative session. But as always, many did not. We're taking a look at the winners and losers next. Plus, the race for Secretary of State normally doesn't get a lot of attention. Not this year. GOP candidate Tina Peters helping to keep it in the spotlight. How a recent court ruling could affect her chances in the primary. Stay there. We're back here on Colorado Point of View. It's been more than 4 months of back and forth right here at the Capitol with your money and crime touching almost everything lawmakers did this session. So when it comes down to it, who are the winners and the losers? Gabrielle Franklin breaks it down.
Coming out of the worst days of the pandemic, lawmakers here at the Capitol had to make decisions on everything ranging from crime to decisions that will impact the youngest Coloradans. And while some groups will leave empty-handed this year, there were others who were able to get everything they intended to.
Law enforcement quietly had a good year at the Capitol. Police agencies were vocal about critical staff shortages and the fentanyl epidemic in the state. Lawmakers approved allocating more than $15 million grant dollars for more diverse staffing and training, and over $10 million for agencies to identify areas of high crime. A key takeaway for officers was the fentanyl prevention and accountability measure. Many advocated for stiffer penalties for people involved with fentanyl. Lawmakers were able to move the threshold down from 4 grams to 1 gram for felony penalties. Another big winner this year is Governor Jared Polis. Since taking office, he's promised to bring universal pre-K to families in Colorado. He successfully put the wheels into motion for the program through legislation at the Capitol this year. Polis came out and said he would not support an effort that would ban the sale of flavored tobacco products, which currently funds the pre-K program. That bill failed to pass its final committee, possibly due to the fact that the governor stated he would not support it. Polis was also against an aspect of the mobile home resident protection measure that would have introduced the state to rent control. After consulting with Polis's office, that aspect died while remaining protections were able to make it out at the Capitol. Because the governor's pool was able to thwart rent control and the flavored tobacco ban, those are the losers of this year's session. At the Capitol, Gabrielle Franklin, Colorado Point of View.
Ask both of you to grade how you think the session has gone so far. Let's take a look at what you say. Andy, you give it a B. Michael Fields, it's barely a passing grade. I know that from experience. At a D minus. Andy, let's start with you. That's our political analyst giving their grades to state lawmakers for the 2022 General Assembly. That was about 3 weeks ago. Not exactly a midterm, but kind of right before the final exam. And just like my old report cards, really old report cards, these grades can change, and they do sometimes. So did they, at least in the eyes of our political analysts? Let's get to it. Democratic strategist, White House and gubernatorial advisor Andy Boyan, and Republican strategist and the director of the Advanced Colorado Institute, Michael Fields. Gentlemen, it's good to see you. So let's take a look at how both of you thought the session went this year now that it is over. Andy, you saw a little bit of improvement there. That's a decent jump. B to an A minus. That's your final. Michael, sticking with that D minus. All right, Andy, you're on the hot seat right now. Sure. Democrats, they have controlled it all for the last 4 years, both chambers of the legislature and the governor's office. Why the A minus? What did you see an improvement with in the last 3 weeks?
You know, I think what happened in the legislatures, we obviously wait till the last moment to pass the most important, the most critical piece of legislation. Happened again here. But what you noticed was, regardless of the Republican antics with filibustering, et cetera, we still got the unemployment system overhauled. We still funded early childhood education. We got fentanyl over the line. And we did some things, obviously, with the federal COVID dollars and the rest. I think it's important to recognize the fact that even in Republican opposition, we still worked well. I happen to agree with Representative Dave Williams of Colorado Springs, who said the Democrats acted in good faith throughout the session. Quote from Dave Williams. I believe that to be true. And I think we did a lot of hard work. I think there's a lot more to be done. But I think Williams is right. We acted in good faith. We did a good job.
Michael, do you agree with that? We'll get to your grade in a second, but this idea that Democrats acted in good faith through the session.
I think they acted like everybody expected them to, which is not really fix some of these big problems that have been going on for years. And that's why I didn't improve their grade at the end of session, because, again, there are two things that they said were the most important, were making Colorado more affordable, making it more safe.
Which we did.
That has not happened at all. You have half measures on things that really deserved full solutions. You think about the fentanyl bill. You can still have a possession that can kill 500 people, in terms of the fentanyl thing. You have
talk to your colleagues about filibustering.
You have a gas tax hike who, is pushed off till April, so we're going to have a gas tax increase come April.
But not this year, thanks to Democrats.
But you look at property taxes. Right. This is still, they're going to hand you a bill, an increase of $1,200, and say, well, we'll cut $250 off of that and thank us for it. Colorado is more expensive. Inflation is worse here than it is anywhere else. Democrats didn't do anything to fix those problems.
Is what Democrats did for this session and what amounts to a couple of years enough? Should they do something more long term to address these issues? Or is that going to get back? Is that kind of kicking the can down the road till next session?
No, I think we should. I think there's a lot more to do all the time, and I think there's constant improvements to be made. But what Michael pointed out is we did relieve Coloradans of some financial burden this year.
Yes, there are opportunities for next year, the last session and the session before.
But this year, we relieved them of some financial obligations they had, and that was our intent. The other thing it's really disappointing is Senate Bill 138, which we were watching closely, the environmental emissions bill, which actually we relented after filibustering would not stop. So these are Republicans that want to improve climate, but yet sit in filibuster and waste time and kill the bill. So there's a lot of different opportunities here for Democrats to take a leadership position. We did. We honored our commitment, and we've got a lot more work to do.
Okay, real quickly before we move on, one thing Republicans really want to get done that you think or that Democrats could do to improve that D-minus grade, say come next year.
Well, I think you have to cap property tax increases is one huge thing that has to happen. Democrats, you look at this, they've increased taxes and fees year after year after year. Election comes up, they say, we're going to give you a break. We know what's going to happen if these people get reelected. Next year, they're going to go right back to what they did for 3.5 years. So I think something like capping property taxes, permanently repealing the gas tax, knowing the gas prices are going to be high, those are the types of things
people
want to see.
How do we pay for those things, Michael? How do we pay for those things?
Okay.
We have a budget that's $40 billion. I mean, this is the biggest budget
true,
ever.
36.5.
Government is overflowing. It's 38.1, almost $40 billion. There's plenty of money there for government to use.
Okay. Well, you must be smarter than every single other legislator on the floor.
Let's move on to another big story this week. A judge removed Mesa County Clerk and Recorder Tina Peters from one of her main duties, overseeing the election, the one in her county. A recap, Peters is facing a number of investigations, has been indicted by a grand jury of her peers on 10 charges related to election and campaign finance issues. She's also accused of obstructing a peace officer for what appears to be trying to kick a cop on camera. Despite that, Peters is on the ballot for the GOP Secretary of State race. Now, whoever wins is going to have a lot of financial ground to make up against the incumbent, Democrat Jenna Griswold. New numbers, take a look at these, show Griswold raised more than $850,000 in the first quarter of this year. A lot for a Secretary of State race. That's well ahead of Peters, former Jefferson County Clerk Pam Anderson, and Mike O'Donnell. Michael, to you, what does this mean for the race? Tina Peters on here, she has a lot of supporters. She has a lot of people behind her who could give her money. Mike Lindell of MyPillow fame is one of them and said he's given her $800,000 so far. Does this mean anything in your eyes for the race coming up in a month and a half now, the primary?
I think the primary is very important, and I don't know if the money situation is going to have that big of an impact on the race in general, given the fact this is going to be a year where Jared Polis is going to spend tens of millions of dollars. The Senate race is going to have tens of millions of dollars, right? I've done statewide races and know that $1 million can only get you so far. I think it is a wave year for Republicans. If they elect the right person in the primary, like Pam Anderson, I think that she can win. You have to remember, the Secretary of State office, Jenna Griswold, is the only Secretary of State, Democratic Secretary of State, who has won since 1958. And so this is something that normally goes Republican. I think it will go again if Republicans pick the right candidate.
Okay. Andy, very quickly, Jenna Griswold will stay in office?
Of course she will. Tina Peters is a joke. I mean, if this is the best they can do, we glide into the Secretary of State's office.
And do you see this idea, very quickly, red wave. He just mentioned a red wave potentially if the right candidates win in the primary and are on the general election ballot.
I think it's a different race if Tina Peters doesn't secure the nomination, but I think right now she's so far ahead in money and she's so far ahead in name ID, she's going to win the nomination. We win the race.
Okay. We'll find out what happens in about a month and a half. Gentlemen, good to see you. We'll be right back. Stay there.
In Grand Junction, I'm Austin Sack. Colorado sure is beautiful with the National Monument right in our backyard.
But as housing developments inch into rural landscapes, it poses a wildfire risk. Colorado Fire Tech, based in Rifle, is looking to the latest technology and to the sky to modernize the future of firefighting. For the first time in our state, Colorado counties can now contract with privately owned companies and their drone pilots to fight fires. In Grand Junction, I'm Austin Sack, Colorado Point of View.
That'll come in handy. I'm Matt Morrow. That'll do it for Colorado Point of View. See you next week.